So after looking at our different settings here, if you've got a brand new YouTube account, you may or may not have as many of the items that I have here on the left, but we were looking under channel. And let's take a quick look here. Let's click on Create. This is what I've been alluding to, especially last week. If you go to Create, you have the audio library and the video editor, audio library. So here are a bunch of musics that we are able to work with. They recently implemented something new that you may or may not like. I don't like it, but I'll tell you what it is here. So we've got a particular song and how long it lasts and the author and so forth. So if I click on Park Bench, for example, and I adjust my volume, we will hear. Hear that track. Let's say that's going to work really well for one of my videos. So I can download it, and remember last week in Movie Maker we added a sound. So I can browse here, I can browse by genre, mood, instrument, duration, attribution. So let's say I'm going to make a 1 minute video. I can go to duration and say, show me videos that are up to 1 minute, or show me songs that are up to 1 minute. So then it organizes them, and I've got them. Still lots and lots and lots of songs up to 1 minute. I can also search. I believe I can mix these. I can say I want 30 up to 1 minute, and I want a mood that is bright. So now it shortened it even more. So we've got hammock fight. Carney's dance. Yeah, this video library is probably 2 or 3 years, but what has just changed is this. If you care about making money off of your YouTube videos, it's highly recommended that you use songs from the library here, that you don't take them from your iTunes library, that you don't rip them from a CD, that you don't use those. Just because you paid 99 cents for that new Taylor Swift song doesn't mean it's okay for you to use it on your video. It's the opposite of okay. But if you go to the library here, it's okay to use these songs, except for the ones that have this little person. You're free to use this song in any of your videos, but you must include the following in your description, blah, blah, blah. So if you don't do that, then you run afoul again of copyrights. So this is what I don't like. It's mixing together the ones that you have to do this and the ones that are totally free, which are under attribution, not required. These are the ones that I would use and recommend. So in my particular case, it didn't find any. Let's say I'm going to say all durations that are bright, not required. There we go. So then I get hundreds of songs that are in the bright style, maybe not the 30 seconds that I needed, but I can cut it in Movie Maker. But then attribution not required. So on these, I don't have to mention in my credits, I don't have to mention in my description. I can use them however I want. These are the ones that I re would recommend. Whatever you filter by, I recommend always at the least put it on attribution not required.
And where do you post that? Is that in the description?
It's going to tell you because some of these, let me see an example. Some of these tell you exactly where to put it. Just get a random one here. Angevine. You must include the following in your description. So this one they wanted in the description. So you have to copy and paste this whole thing into your description, and then it's okay really for you to use the video. Some of these songs also are more restrictive, but if you really want that song, let's say Impact Prelude. If that's the perfect song for your video, you have it there. You're not going to go to your CD collection and take a song from there, even though you paid $15 for that CD. Doesn't work that way. You only have the rights for private use, not commercial or public use. And here, they give you a bunch of free ones for you to use. And the most free are the ones that you change attribute, not required. Yes?
I don't understand that last thing. The most free means going to cost you something if you use the attribution required at some point?
The thing about free in computer terms can be free as in freedom and free as in beer.
Okay.
So free beer is different than freedom,
mm-hmm.
right? So what I'm kind of saying it in terms more of freedom rather than free beer. No, you're not going to need to pay any of these for any of these. But I'm saying that to have the most freedom to use them, I would do the attribution not required, because you're going to need to make that attribution. And if you don't, you're not going to pay for it, but your video might be taken down temporarily until you fix it. Exactly. It's going to tell you right on that screen, but you may never think really to look, because you see you're going to, you know, if you click download Beach Party, it'll download it. But it will pop up here. Don't forget to put this in your description.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I ignored it,
right.
Or I didn't notice it. So the onus is still on you to give proper attribution. This is under the Free Music tab. We have ad-supported music as well. View usage restrictions for popular music. So here you will be able to see some music of real artists.
Look at that. You can get this Justin Bieber track.
Mm-hmm.
This Khalifa. Mark Ronson.
So these you are able to use on your videos. However, you're going to see that your video will not be playable in Germany.
Mm-hmm.
Is there some kind of Justin Bieber ban or something?
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm sorry, I missed the start of this. So, you can use these, but the stipulation is that they will play an ad for your video?
Well, basically, all our videos are going to have ads anyway. But the stipulation is here is that you can use this song in your videos. Perhaps a different Justin Bieber song is not available for our videos. But here it's going to tell you these from these artists are okay for you to use in your videos. When I said earlier, don't go to your iTunes library, don't rip that song, you have to check if that song that you want is available here.
It's the same thing as the first free music, except how?
Except that these are official, famous, more famous artists than here. Some of these are artists that like Bizet. That's a classical music artist that his copyrights have expired. Audionautics might be a band that is currently right now active, but they are choosing to give away their music without any stipulation for more fame. Justin Bieber doesn't need to give away his music, but he could sure use more fame. So he and these other artists here have chosen to make these songs available for people to use, but not certain other songs. As long as they're on the list here, you can use them.
You have to use this file?
Well, that's the thing. There's no file to download, but it's just telling you you can use that song if you have that song.
Oh, that's cool.
Yes.
When it says playback viewable everywhere except for Germany, will they see the video, just not hear the audio, or everything?
It's gonna be black, and it's gonna have a sad face, and it's gonna say this content is not available in your region.
Got it.
So it's not that they will see it; they will just see nothing.
Mm-hmm.
So let's see something else. Wiz Khalifa's is saying this is viewable worldwide. Copyright owner can change their policies at any time. So I can use that song. I can use Gangnam Style. Viewable worldwide. Ads can appear. That has to do with revenue sharing. If you do choose to set up monetization, some of these songs are okay for you to use in your video, but you can't make money off of your video. So this is a whole rat's nest of stuff, but if you choose to explore here, eligible for revenue sharing is what setting I would further set here. I do want to use that Psy song, and I do want to make money off of my YouTube videos, so I will turn on eligible for revenue sharing. when someone clicks that ad in my video, instead of me getting 10 cents off of it, I will get 6 cents because the other cents go to Sai. So that's better safe than sorry. Don't just take a song off of your YouTube, out of your iTunes library. Check if you're able to use a song from the list. And it's unfortunately not millions of songs, but it's lots and lots of songs. Katy Perry, Last Night, TGIF, you can use that in your videos. And I can apparently also monetize them. Yes?
So when the opposite of what you just said, that revenue sharing is not available, what does that mean?
That means if you use that song in your video and you try to make money off of it, your video will be taken down. Yes.
Your video already has sound. So in this case, this would not apply. It's only if you don't have.
Exactly. And the song that I gave you, I got from this free music library. So I already set myself up that. Bubblegum Ballgame, right there. The song that I gave us last week, I got it from the library. So I already went to the right place to give you the best results.
And you were on the Microsoft, you were using Microsoft application, that's the Movie Maker?
Movie Maker.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And lastly, we have sound effects. So if we need a sound effect for our video, let's see, category, horror, Halloween's coming up, so we've got some sounds here, such as aggressive zombie snarl. Alien snarl. Now, I haven't mentioned, but notice also on the side here, this little meter. How popular is it? So these sound effects that have the higher meter means they're popular. It doesn't tell you how many, but that means lots of people are downloading a particular sound effect or song. So everyone apparently loves the cutting flesh sound. It's got a very high one. But not too many people like the drop meat sound. Yeah, I don't know. Not very loud. So, if I was back over on free music, same sort of thing. Let's say I honed in on the perfect one. I went to genre of classical, and then I went to mood of dramatic. And it's cutting it down. And then right here. So a lot of people are getting Avaneta by Bizet. So that's a popular one. And then other ones not so popular. Sila Rigur, etc. 18th Overture for some reason is not popular. Hard to believe. But that's just something to consider if you care at all that you've uploaded a video with a particular soundtrack and so have 1,000 others that may or may not matter to you. But that's what the popularity means. Other people have also used that song. How many? It doesn't tell you.
And revenue sharing, just one more time. That's only for the ads, the money you make from your ads, right? That's how they get revenue from it. Like, let's say I make one for an advertisement, and I put it on TV as well, and all that stuff. That's completely different.
That's going to be different. This only applies to YouTube, but now regular TV is bleeding into YouTube and vice versa. But the revenue sharing really is only applicable on what's happening on YouTube.
Okay, and they make money off of the clicks from the ad. Right?
Yeah.
Got it.
They make money, you make money, that's the revenue sharing. Okay, let's now go over to dashboard. Because I've got a brand new account, I can't really see anything behind this yet, but the dashboard is what would show me statistics and such. And I'm gonna get deeper statistics in the analytics screen. We'll look at that later. But right now it's telling me you don't have any videos yet. So we have a video. Again, you can choose to upload this to fully learn this and then delete it later if you want, or use your own video. But here under upload video, go ahead and click that, upload video. Did you go to dashboard? If you don't have that, you also have a button on the very top right corner that says upload. So then we have the upload button, and here then you've got a bunch of things that we can do. We can upload the video, but notice on the right side also, if you've got Google Photos, you can import those. I've never really done it, so I don't really know what to say about that. I don't think it'll make a slideshow or anything. I don't know. I don't know what that really will be about, but it just seems that if you've got videos in your Google Photos, you can transfer them, I guess. Live streaming is a whole can of worms we won't really get into, but if you've got a web camera and such, you can do live streaming. We can record. If I've got a web camera, I can record a video right now. I guess photo slideshow and video editor. So you've got some basic things that we can do here, but we've got a video ready already, so we can upload. Before we do that, we have the options here. Public, unlisted, private. Public is that as soon as you upload the video and it's ready, everyone in the world could see it. Unlisted is that it's up on YouTube, but no one can see it unless they have the link to the video. So if they have the link, then they can see it. So think about using that, let's say, on an email campaign. Let's say you've got a video that you uploaded only for certain people of your email list. And so if you've got it unlisted, you send out an email to your followers on the list, and it'll say, follow this link, watch our video, watch our exclusive video, and only they that have the link can see it, which means anyone that has the link could see it. So the people on that mailing list could forward it to 10 of their friends, and now 10 people that you didn't think now could see it. The third option is private. This one's much more restrictive. If you set it to private, no one in the world can see it, even if they have the link. They have to be approved. They have to be on the list. Just like when you want to get into that club, you gotta be on the list. So you can add names, Google Plus circles, or email addresses. And unfortunately, then there isn't a very easy way to upload a whole list of 10 people that can see this video. If you've got them set up in Google Plus circles, then you just name the circle here, right? These are my customers. But it's tied to Google Plus, and if you haven't used Google Plus, then it's not going to be that useful. So private really might not be as useful as you think. If you want to keep the distribution of this video to a very core group of people, private would be it, but it needs some setup. I'm going to keep it on public. And it still will not automatically show to the world until we click on the next screen, publish. But I'm going to keep it on public. You can drag the video, or you can click on that big arrow, and that gives us the picker, the file picker. Go find your file. Mine's on the desktop. That's my video on the desktop. I'm going to click it and then open. depending on the length of the video, depending on your internet connection, this may take a while. This is uploading relatively quickly, that's good. The video. No, it's called Victor Review Moto X or something. The video we made last week.
Is it the MP4?
Well, I work my way out. Thank you.
Is this the MP4?
That's right. Scroll down. It's the video. The one that you copied at the beginning of the day. You should have copied it. It's awesome. Okay, so there's several steps here. I clicked the button and it uploaded. At the top here, it was showing uploading progress. After it uploads, then there's processing. Mine seemed to have happened really fast because it's a short video. It's about 1.5 minutes or so. But if I had a 5-minute, 10-minute video, this would take longer. It would take longer to upload, longer to process. So in this screen here, if it's taking a long time, I can see on the left side, video audio quality. Your video will process faster if you encode it in a streamable format. Click here to read. Okay, so more help from YouTube about how to do well on YouTube. There's also another one that you can go next. We detected your video may be shaky. Would you like us to stabilize it? So you're going to get some little pop-ups here.
I haven't found that stabilizing it really does help, or is it sometimes too?
I don't like it too much. The algorithm is getting better, but sometimes it can make the video feel very dreamy because movement is suddenly going to be kind of slowed down and it's going to be different. So we always have the ability to check before and after, and if we don't like the after results, we can revert back to the original video. So this screen is very important, but one of the things that beginners often do, so take a note of this, do not click publish until you're ready for the world to see your video. Because if you go away from this screen, we will not be able to get back to it in the same way. So here, processing is done, click publish to make your video live, but I haven't done anything here to craft my video. I haven't done anything to optimize my video. When we were on the settings screen, in general we were optimizing our channel and such, but now we've got a particular video that I want to craft. I have two tabs here, basic and advanced. You might also have monetize if you went through the process of monetization. So under basic info, what's the title of this video? You have the ability here to type as much as you want, but at a certain point YouTube will tell you, hey, that's a little long, it's gonna cut off right there. Title is too long. But it can be pretty long. You want to be as accurate and of course truthful as possible as to what your video is. So in this case, review of the Moto E. That's a possible name of this YouTube video. That's what it is. It's a review of the Moto E. But thinking further ahead regarding SEO, if I'm building a brand, if I'm building this company and this presence online, I probably want to think like a brand. I could have, perhaps, didn't I call this the on-the-go review? So on-the-go review, Moto E. I'm developing a series of videos. Every time I'm on the go, I'm gonna take a quick moment to record a review. So I've got a concept there for my brand. It's the on-the-go review. And this month is the Moto E. So that's a little bit better of a title, because I've got the term review. People are gonna search for Moto E reviews or Moto E review. So I've got those keywords, Moto E and review. And I've also got the branding on the go. That's the name of my series of videos that I'm putting together and putting out every month. Maybe I am a particular brand as well, by Victor C. Again, depending on what audience you're trying to reach and such. If I already built an audience on Twitter and I tell people on Twitter, don't forget to check out my reviews, well, they're gonna browse YouTube and maybe find me. If I'm Victor C on Twitter, and I'm also Victor C on YouTube, that's synergy. That's my different channels, my different social networks coming together. The description automatically has my address because I added it in the defaults. I can, of course, take it out if I want, but why would I? I want people to visit my site. Maybe I could say victor.com for more reviews. And then here, I don't know what the limit is, but I believe you can write dozens and dozens, if not hundreds, of characters here. You can write a whole, you know, half a page of text. Not everyone's gonna read it, but that helps you also to get found. When someone searches, they could find you via the title, via the description, via the tags. So if I take time to write a couple of sentences to describe this video with my keywords and concepts, I could stand a better chance to be found. So I'm gonna write Victor C. reviews the Motorola Moto E. This smartphone features many great new Android options. It's perfect for beginners. So I'm just making some stuff up, but I'm just trying to say, who would this video be good for? What are some of these keywords that people might search? You know, smartphone beginners. Smartphone beginners. I could be searching for, people could be searching for many of these concepts and keywords. So if I'm taking the time to write stuff here that will stand out for people, I've done a good job. Again, this is an art and a science. This is the whole concept of SEO. Tags. We've got options here. Albert Einstein, Flying Pig, Mashup. So tags, keywords that can further get me found. And what I would do first, if you have suggested tags, select as many as apply. It's suggesting the Moto E, so I'll click on it. Now Moto E has become a tag, a popular tag. That's going to help me get found. So if there's any suggestions, take them, if they apply. It's not always so smart. Sometimes it gives me these suggestions that are just so off base, don't use them, because they don't apply to your video. YouTube wants to crack down on spam videos. There's so many videos out there that have a title and a description that does not apply to the video. And then those videos get taken down, they get downvoted, they get marked as spam, they don't get views. So always, again, be honest, be direct, be specific. While I'm on this screen, I'm gonna start to write review. And then it gives me suggestions. Again, take any of these that really apply. Take as many of them as you want. We've got Review Media, Review and Herald, Review on the Run, TV program, Review with Miles Barlow, Review Site, website category. That applies. This is a video of my review from my review site. I'll select it. Let me try again. Review Media Genre. Yeah, that applies. Film Media Genre. No, I'm not doing a video about film. I would skip that one. What else? Opinions. What else? What other keywords make up this video? Anyone have any? What's that? Motorola?
Moto E?
It already took Moto E.
Oh, sorry. I guess it's also very
bad. Let's say Motorola. That's the name of the company that created this phone. You've got Motorola Award winner, Motorola Droid. Tips?
Android.
Well, those are some good suggestions. I'm starting to type tips. It says, do you mean Tipsport Arena? Tipsy? Tips and Tricks? The magazine? Before we get that complex, tips for smartphone beginners. No, it's not going to give me a suggestion like that. But we can do that if we wanted. We can have that huge tag if we want it. But if we go with suggestions that it gives us, that's going to be better. Yes?
At this point, you had misspelled smartphone on there, and after you make it a tab, does that mean you have to erase the whole tab, or can you go back in and correct the smartphone spelling from that tab?
How did I misspell it?
Smartphone with a P-H-O-N-E.
Well, let's say it's misspelled like that. So, if I added that tag, I would have to delete it and add it properly.
Okay.
So notice we can delete these ones by clicking the X.
Did you remind me, the test, are you, is it safe to...
In a sense, I would say as many as you want, but I wouldn't do like 50 or 30 or even 20. I would say try to get within 10, 5 to 10. Because again, too many is going to dilute your brand, and you're going to be kind of spammy when you've got all of these tags that maybe don't apply. So 5 or 10. And some of them are kind of weird because, okay, I want smartphone. That's clearly what this is about. But it's suggesting smartphone, the video game platform. Not really. So you don't have to take a suggestion, but you can add a tag also like this, smartphone in quotes. That way you can force a particular tag. It may be suggesting something, but if I really need it to be something else, because it's not going to give you every single tag in the world, you can put it in quotes. You can write it and then press, write it in quotes and press tab, and then it'll write it.
When you say a newer model shows up and you want to review the next generation of models, how do you remove that one?
You mean remove the tag or remove the video? I would not remove your old videos. That's going to be views that you lose. That's going to be traffic that you lose. So I would keep the old videos there, but what we can do, we can go back to the old video and go back to the description and write, watch our newest review. So someone that comes across the old video will have a link to take them to the new review. So I've got 5 tags here. I could probably think of some more. But here I want to add some keywords where people can search. Okay, so there's millions of YouTube videos uploaded every day. So that means there's lots and lots and lots of videos out there. When someone is looking at a screen full of possible YouTube videos to watch, they're going to see a thumbnail. If they only see this thumbnail, and I've zoomed in so you can see the word email analysis, and we made the video together so we know that it says email analysis, but someone that stumbles upon my review is not going to understand, what's this video about? Is this angry guy talking about the government analyzing his emails? So, crafting the perfect thumbnail. YouTube gave me three possible options. YouTube tries to give me an option of a thumbnail from somewhere near the beginning of your video, somewhere near the center of your video, and somewhere at the end. That's exactly what I've got right here. So one of these two thumbnails at the end might be better to catch people's attention. Hey, this is a review of a phone, probably, not some angry guy. So if I were to select this one or that one, that might be better results. If I set that thumbnail, it's not going to show up right away, perhaps. But I've selected that thumbnail, and that's what's going to be, that's how people can judge a book by its cover. That's how you can make that first impression, with a good thumbnail. Now sometimes it's not picking a good thumbnail, because it's only going to really randomly choose approximately three places in your video. What are the odds that somewhere in the middle, at the end, or at the beginning, you're going to have the perfect thumbnail? Kind of low. I don't have the option here. There's a fourth option. Choose a thumbnail. Upload a thumbnail. I don't have that, because I haven't verified my account. Remember back on the settings, there was an option that says activate video thumbnails, I think it was called, but you needed to verify. So once you verify, then you're able to select your own handcrafted thumbnail. Question?
Mine says customized thumbnail.
That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
So I forgot the name of it, but it's the fourth option. Okay. Customized thumbnail. Customizes for you to choose your own thumbnail. Now that means that I upload my own thumbnail that I design in Photoshop, for example. And what I will say is that if you are going to make your own thumbnails, you want to make thumbnails of this particular size right here. YouTube thumbnail size. 1920 pixels by 1080 pixels. HD quality, basically. So in Photoshop or Illustrator or Paint, whatever software you have, you want, if you're going to make your own thumbnails, you're going to use those sizes. Yes?
Can you customize your own thumbnail? Can you, instead of creating one, go back through your video and choose?
I have a memory, and I don't know if it really happened or what, but I have a memory of being able to do that. I haven't been able to see that recently in YouTube, however, so I don't know if they removed that. I think I was able to do that, but now I don't see it anymore. So you have to do this. What's that?
You have to experiment.
Yeah.
I missed something. I thought you got to... Well, you're making a note to yourself to create one, but where do you go to create the thumbnail?
You need some sort of graphics software like Photoshop. Oh. Question in the back.
Yeah, once you go to Google Images to pick up a Moto E picture, but they don't have anything that's 1920 by 1080, but they have stuff that's bigger.
If it's bigger, what you want to do is have at least a minimum of these dimensions. If the dimensions are higher, that's fine. It should compress it down. But if it's smaller, not so good. But let me back up. You really don't want to just go find a picture on Google and upload it, because it's not unique. It's not handcrafted. It's not probably copyright legal for you to do. Perhaps if you find the picture and then take the picture and mix it with some other original content and make it new, that might be better. Or maybe if you do have the product itself, take a photo of it yourself. And yes, there is a whole genre of product photography and its own challenges and such. But the point of all of this stuff, Twitter, Google+, Pinterest, everything, really is original content. So at
Can
the
you
minimum...
Can you go to the website for Motorola and take their picture?
Same thing.
Same thing?
Same thing. You didn't shoot the picture. I don't recommend you use other people's content. Make your own content. These companies, though, it's really tricky. I'm going to be pretty adamant and say don't use other people's pictures. But you can probably go to the companies and go to the press kit section, and they're probably going to give you a high-quality version of their products because they want the free press. But I'm going to say, in general, don't use other people's pictures unless you do the legwork to find out if it's okay. I don't want to do the legwork. Just assume you can't use the pictures. When you craft, when you customize your own thumbnail, then this is also another art and science, because here, these thumbnails are rather small. From a distance, from where you're at, you cannot read that. That's some white smudge on my picture. When I'm standing in front of the monitor, I can kind of read it, and I know what it says because I designed this video. But for a person looking at a whole screen full of thumbnails, if they can't see that on one, if they can't realize what the thumbnail is in 1 second, it's not a good thumbnail. So just to kind of show you here, here's an example of a of my YouTube channel. This is my personal private, or my own personal for fun YouTube channel. Take a look at some of these thumbnails that I've made here. This is a thumbnail that came straight from the video. It's not so good, but it's got some views. Oh, it just crossed 1,000 views on that. So you can kind of see, okay, using a smartphone. But look at these other ones that I took much more effort. I actually shot this product in a white box and everything, put the text. You might not be able to see everything about it, but what stands out? Remember Virtual Boy over here, unboxing Samus. So you're dealing, even though you're dealing with 1920 by 1080, which is a big image, you still have to think that they're going to be seen possibly this small and maybe even a little smaller on a smartphone. So this, I'm kind of pushing the envelope right here. A lot of text. But even when it's small like this, it's still readable enough, especially if you're standing in front of it. So this is an art and a science to craft these thumbnails. Basically, go big and go bold. Don't put a lot of small details. And the thumbnail that it chooses for you might not be the best. You want to craft your own thumbnail.
I have a question. What do you think about doing that in PowerPoint?
If PowerPoint can then save your file, your presentation file, as a regular graphic, which would be JPEG or PNG, then that could be something that you could do.
Okay.
Just let me finish my thought here. So JPEG or PNG. I think when you want to customize it, it'll tell you. JPEGs or PNGs, maybe one more. But JPEGs or PNGs is the format of your graphic. You can't upload a RAW file. You can't upload a TIFF. Or whatever. So these would be your formats. Question.
I was just going to suggest for at least a Photoshop, if you don't have Photoshop, if it's too complex, I highly recommend Picasa.
Picasa?
They have an excellent spotting system and many tools for formatting. And
that might be useful. Picasa, it's free and it's part of Google.
Yeah.
Picasa. Mm-hmm. Question?
That size that you recommended, is that a size that's safe to post? In other words, it's not something that, it's a size that someone couldn't. See, I posted a great photo, and can someone take that? And
we're only dealing with the size of the thumbnail. So all of these thumbnails right here originally are that size, and they're still that size. So if someone looks at my YouTube videos on their big screen TV, it will show the larger version. If they look at it on a monitor, it's a little smaller. If they look at it on a mobile device, it's even smaller. So the question about is it safe, that's totally a moot point, because you need a thumbnail, number one, and it needs to be that size. So you have to be comfortable about whatever you're putting into that photo, is you're comfortable that it travels all over the internet.
It's kind of strange, you know, that you just change, choose your thumbnail throughout the movie.
Exactly, and I said, I thought I have a memory. I don't know if it was an implanted memory or something, but I have a memory of going through my video to choose the right frame. Maybe they took that out because they want you to take the effort to make a good thumbnail like this. Like this. There's no shot in that video, which is 3 hours long, by the way. There's no shot in that video that looks like that. I made a very simple graphic in Photoshop, and I added it to my video. This one here is a shot from the video, but then I overlaid this text in Photoshop. This is something I could make easily in PowerPoint.
So does that mean it belongs to you now?
All of this belongs to me, because I made it.
Okay.
Except, but I see what you're saying about the Comic-Con stuff there. That was in a public showing, a public venue, and it was okay related to the venue itself. If I was in a conference where it was not okay to record and I put that up there, then I'd be perhaps treading on thin
people.
Ice.
Like you didn't have access to those people, but you put some print on it, so is it now okay to use because you modified it? It's now yours?
No, I did shoot that photo.
Oh,
that's
you did.
What I'm saying. I did shoot that photo. As for the people, they were there because they wanted to be photographed. If this was a private event with no photography and I did this, then it could be problematic.
Okay, got it.
Yes. In this particular case, no, because they were in a place where the photography was assumed and encouraged, and it was supposed they were there because they wanted to be photographed. If they didn't want their photograph to be taken, or if I was in a private venue, then I'd have to get some sort of release and such. Or for example, if, like I've mentioned, the client that is a restaurant, when the Travel Channel came to record, they had a sign on the door that says, "Notice, recording is happening on these premises. If you do not wish to be included in the recording, do not enter the premises." So if someone enters the premises, they've given consent to be recorded. That's not ironclad, of course. Someone could say, "I never saw it." Then that's when the court comes in. But if you have more protection, more of it in writing, the better. But these events, you know, they happened in this public venue where it was, where everyone was okay to be recording. Okay, so other things that we have within this screen, okay, we have to craft all this. That's why we don't want to rush and click publish right away, because then your YouTube video will be out there not optimized. We will be able to come back to edit the video, but we might as well do it right before we publish. Furthermore, on this screen, we can still set the privacy of it. Public, unlisted, private. If you connect your Google Plus account and your YouTube, you can also automatically share this video to your YouTube, I'm sorry, to your Google Plus or your Twitter. So I don't have my Twitter connected, but if I click that on, it'll say log into Twitter. And what will happen then is once I click publish, this will then also tweet for me that my video is available. If I wanted to say something specific, I can add a message there. Latest review is available. The Moto E. And then when I would click publish, not yet, when I would click publish, this would go off to YouTube, and it would also go off to Google Plus and Twitter.
Is there a way to add Facebook?
I think there used to be the Facebook service here, but they're rivals, so they took it off. You'll have to do it manually. You can always do that, but it would be nice if I can share to more networks from this screen. From a different screen that we'll see, we can share, but on this screen it's most convenient with Google Plus and Twitter. The last thing on this tab is playlists. I don't have any playlists. Playlists are just folders for you to organize your videos. All my how-to videos will be in the how-to playlist. All of my top 10 lists will be in the top 10 playlist. This is optional, but highly useful, because as you start to add more videos, people will get lost. What can I see? Where was that video? How do I get back to it? But if you organize in playlists, that means you'll be found easier, and your repeat viewers can come back easier. And the way we would create a playlist here is, you click on that. If there exists any playlists, they will be listed here. I don't have any. So I'm going to click Create a Playlist. Reviews. All my reviews will go in this playlist. But to further my branding, why don't I call it On the Road Review? Is that what I call it? On the Road Review? I forgot. Review. On the Go Review, yes. On the Go Review. So you can call these playlists anything you want, and they're just basically to organize your videos, and I recommend you use them. Different kinds of videos should go in different kinds of playlists. People can see any of your videos, of course, but if they want to see specific videos in a specific playlist, they can do so. And the playlist itself can be public, unlisted, or private. So you can type a title, click Create.
Can you create more than one title for the playlist?
Yeah, I can also do here Android. It's also going to go into my Android playlist, so I can have more than one playlist. People that care about Android stuff will see the video, and people that care about the On the Road Review will see the video. Any questions on this screen? This is basic stuff. Let's look at advanced. Here's the part again, on a video-by-video basis, we can choose all of this stuff. This was filled in for us in the settings, but we can always change it. Maybe this is a highly controversial video where I really put down that smartphone, and all the fanboys of that particular smartphone are going to come after me. No, they won't. Turn off comments. Or I can leave it as I want here. Show comments after I've approved them. Show comments. Show any crazy comment as soon as they've written it. I don't recommend that one. So, approved. And then this is new. This is pretty useful. Top comments or newest first. The top comments are going to be the ones when people click a thumbs up to a comment. If someone writes, "That's a stupid jacket and I hate that phone," and then people are going to give that thumbs down because it doesn't even apply to the video. So then that comment will go lower and lower. But then people might say, "I really like that review. I learned a lot." They give that a thumbs up. That's going to rise to the top. So if we say, "Show the top comments," that again will guide the conversation probably more positively than having the newest, because the last review might be the negative one. You might have seven good comments, and the eighth comment is negative. It's the first thing people will see. So if you leave it on the default, show the best comments first. That's better, I think. And when people like or thumbs up their comments, do you want people to see that, yes or no? That's up to you. I'll leave it yes. The license is filled in for me. Caption is filled in. Syndication. Where would you like to display your video? Everywhere in the world is good, or only target specific places? I can't change it because I didn't verify my account yet. Question?
I just don't know how you got to that page and was doing something. Did you open your YouTube?
No, nope, I have not published my video yet. I'm still under basic and advanced. If you don't see that screen, you'll have to wait for me to come back. We've got category, which we can change, video location, language, recording date. This is not set by default.
Sorry, do you have a video? I don't have anything for video location. Is that because you have an account from before, or?
That's when we were back on the settings a little while ago. the default settings, I did put a default setting. If you didn't put a default setting, nothing shows up. And that's okay. You don't have to have a location for your video, but I just chose to put in a location.
Okay, I remember.
And then when was this recorded? I actually recorded it a few days ago. This doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be accurate, but if you need it to be, you can choose a particular date, October 1st, or you can put today. We can do 3D videos on YouTube, but unfortunately, it's not that you upload a video and turn this on and suddenly you have a 3D video. Just like a movie in theaters does not automatically become 3D. They have to film it with special cameras. So if you recorded your video in 3D, you mark here, it's in 3D. I've never met anyone that recorded a 3D video, personally, so I almost never have any opportunity to turn this on. So don't even worry about it. Content declaration. Partners are permitted to include paid product placement or endorsements. All product placements will need to conform to our ad policy. So if I'm talking about this Motorola, Moto E, and Motorola sent me a free Moto E to review, that's a product placement. So I would say this includes that. Now, I didn't get one for free. I bought it myself, so that's different. I'm not going to turn that on. This is really only if you're being paid to review something, if you're being paid to promote something, if you're given something for free to review, conflict of interest. If you get that free lawnmower, you're probably going to say how great it is because you want another free lawnmower later. That's always the conflict between endorsements and celebrities and people and such. So, for example, consumer reviews. They've been around decades. They review lots and lots and lots of products. They never take free stuff from the client, from the companies. They always go out and buy everything. They then do these unbiased reviews because if they got that free Toyota to test, they want another one next year when the new model comes out. So if you've been paid for your videos and such, you should declare that. I have not, we have not, so I'm not going to turn that on. Any questions then on this screen?
I do, I don't know if it matters, but where it says distribution options without embedding, what if I didn't want other people to use that? Do they get some kind of message?
Oh, sorry, there's a whole section I forgot to mention. Yes, distribution options, allow embedding, notification, subscribers. Okay, allow embedding. This is just like we're able to easily retweet, we're easily able to repin on Pinterest, we're easily able to share a video on YouTube. Within YouTube, to Facebook, to my blog, we're able to share. And for most people, that's a great thing. That means I can get my product, my video, shown to more people. But maybe I don't want my video to be shared. So that's why I would turn that off. Don't let my video be shared. That's what that's about.
So they're wondering why they can't download or upload or whatever.
Exactly. They can only view it.
It doesn't say, hey, this is not allowable.
No, it's just not going to have the option. They won't even know. So for most of us, I would recommend leave that on. Let people share it. I want to go viral. I want my video to be shared on someone's blog and then to get lots of hits and to get famous. Or maybe you don't, so turn it off. When you have Twitter, you have followers. When you have Facebook, you have likes. When you have YouTube, you have subscribers. Those are the people that have chosen to follow your YouTube channel. So every time you upload something new, they get a notification and can therefore watch your video. If you don't want this particular video to be sent out to your subscribers, you turn that off. They can, of course, still manually go back to your YouTube channel themselves. Maybe they bookmarked the link. They can still go back to the YouTube channel and view the video. It's just not going to let them know, hey, there's a new video. I would recommend you leave both of these on. And the last option, is this age restricted? Is there alcohol? Is there adult content? Is there violence? Do you want it to be restricted to ages? If you do, then an account needs to have a verified age before they view your video. But notice it says this also removes the ability to monetize or promote your video throughout different formats. All right, so after crafting all of this important stuff, now I will click Publish. There's the link to my video. I can then put that into my email. I can share it to Facebook, Blogger, Reddit, Tumblr, Pinterest. Embed, here's the code to embed it into my website, and here's a way for me to email it directly to people. And no, it's not robust enough to include an email distribution list of 40 people, or 400. Yes?
Is that coming from YouTube email, or is it coming from your website that you listed on there?
It's coming from YouTube.
Emails.
The email, it'll say, I don't remember what it says exactly, but it'll say, you know, the from will be YouTube, and then some address, and then the subject will be what you write here, and it shows you what it's going to look like.
And that doesn't end up in spam?
It could. It depends on the person's email settings.
Okay. What's the difference again
between share?
Embed is that you put this directly on your website. And share is that you save it on your Twitter or you save it on your Reddit or your Tumblr. So the last thing we'll do here, then we'll take a break. Well, actually, we're getting close to the end of the day, so we'll skip the break. What we'll do here is if you now, on the top right corner, click on your icon and go back to Creator Studio again. And now on the dashboard, we have these things that we can see, such as tips, how many subscribers and views you have. News will appear there.
Victor, how much do you say you earned? $11? Mm-hmm. Is that all for all your work?
Mm-hmm.
Is that really worth to do ad sense or?
You need to do it though. If you do the AdSense and you set that up, then you will collect money. If you don't have AdSense set up, you won't collect anything.
You do.
Yeah, I have it set up.
So you don't make a lot of money. Nobody makes a lot of money.
No, someone made about $20 million off YouTube last year.
Really?
Yeah, one of these crazy teens that does crazy things online.
Okay. They
earned $20 million on YouTube.
Okay.
But they live their lives on YouTube and upload stuff every day, and you have a lot of followers, and popularity breeds popularity, and they go viral and all of that, and so people can make a lot of money on YouTube.
Okay.
So in my dashboard, it shows me my video, and if I want to further edit it, I can click Edit, and that takes me back here. Choose my thumbnail, edit my basic or advanced info. So if you got out of that screen previously, that's what you want to do. Back to your dashboard, edit your video.
Can you remind me where to go to verify?
That's under Channel, and it's the first setting, Status. So under this screen, I get back here again the editing, and if you make any changes, because then I could say, you know, 2 months from now, I can add to the description, check the latest review.
Is this somewhere
you've just let me finish my thought here. I've got check the latest review, and if I have the address for my other video, youtube.com/theothervideo, then that will be an active link to take me to the new video. Then I can click save, And now I've updated that old video that had some traffic to maybe bring traffic to my new video. Question?
Is this where you would put a transcript?
It'd be right on top over here. Subtitles and captions. So what's cool about going back to edit your video is not only can you maybe fix mistakes or update it or whatever, but you have these things on top. Enhancements. So we have some filters that we can add. Another on the road review. So I'm on the road and I'm going to review the next product here.
Yeah.
So this is the Motorola.
If you go back here,
Moto
do you have a
phone? It's a really good phone. It's very high tech.
So I have this basic enhancements.
To,
I can do filters. So I can make it black and white.
To just by a voice. So it's very, very cool. So the Motorola Moto X is very cool because it really learns about you. It analyzes all of your email and everything that you do.
Slow motion, fast motion, basic trimming.
Hello everyone and welcome to another On The Road review. So I'm on the road and I'm going to review the next product here. So this is the Motorola.
So that's something you can look on your own, but
hello,
those are enhancements that you add to a video
review.
After you've uploaded.
So I'm on the road and I'm going to review.
You can also add music to your video, but in this case it would not make sense because I've already added music to my video. So I wouldn't even bother with that.
Hello everyone.
Annotations. Annotations are ways to make hotspots on your video. Have you seen videos where someone is
Hello,
talking
everyone.
About a product
another
and
on the road
little
review.
Little
so I'm on the road and I'm going
to watch my other review.
The next product
that's
here.
Annotations.
So this is the Motorola.
This
Moto
is not difficult,
phone.
But
it's, really
it's got its own
very
little section
tech.
Here. Add an
it's
annotation. Make it a label.
To...
So right here, it's something's going to pop up.
If I get a message about again.
Send and receive messages via voice. So it's very, very cool. So the Motorola Moto X is very cool because it really learns about you. It analyzes all of your email and
yeah,
everything
this screen
that you
requires
do
flash.
So that it really
Adobe
keeps
flash.
You on track. Like right here, I'm
on,
I got to get
so
on the road to get to,
saying
the,
this
to my
work,
next job. And this is
in.
Reminding me, it's telling
plug-in.
Me, it's pretty smart. Got a lot of features such as the ability to send and receive messages via voice, so it's very, very cool. So the Motorola Moto
this can
X
be pretty
is
powerful,
very...
but the pros do this. They go into their videos and add annotations. So you see, it's not over. It's not over after you've uploaded the video and added your descriptions and such. You should also go back to edit your video and, as necessary, add annotations. Mm-hmm. If I've got this particular video. That would be a good idea to link to another video. I would go to annotations and I would add an annotation of any one of these, note, title, whatever. And any one of these, like a note, I can make a note appear on top here and give it a link. So obviously this takes some setup. Link it to another video, link it to a link, link it to something. Again, that's why we took 2 days in this class, because there's just so much to talk about YouTube. But I'm showing you at least what does the saying go about teach someone to, or give someone a fish and they can eat for a day, teach them to fish and they can feed their family or something. So if you then kind of learn these concepts, you'll be able to do more than simply upload a video. Yeah.
The annotation, is that also where you can possibly correct some verbal mistakes that you made?
Yeah. Exactly. People use that as well, because there's no way for me to create the correct video and replace the old video. If I replace the old video, it deletes it. It deletes all my traffic, all my statistics. That's why you never want to really delete your old videos. That still gives you traffic. So yes, use annotations to write here, sorry, I meant the Moto E, which literally happens here. I was talking about the Moto E, and at a certain point I mentioned the Moto X. So I would go in here and I said, sorry, I meant the Moto E, if it matters. Annotations.
The songs that came up, are those free?
Yeah.
Do you get to determine how long the annotation stays up on the screen?
Yeah, it's all here. Once you add an annotation, then you have it starts at this point and it ends at that point, so then it can last 10 seconds or whatever you want.
Why don't we have a music tab?
In this case, I wouldn't worry about it again because we've already uploaded a video with the right music. If we uploaded a video with no music, then I would care, but usually I wouldn't use the YouTube music picker here. I would actually design our video with music built in. If you do make any changes to annotations, you have to remember to apply changes. I'm not going to apply any changes yet. Or I'm
Hello,
not going
to
save. I'm just kind of testing this out because now I want to look at cards. This is brand new on YouTube. It's been available definitely less than a year, maybe like 6 months. Cards are another way to further drive.
So I'm on the road and I'm going to review the
actions by the user. Annotations pop up and they might have some text and so forth. Cards are
very
similar. There's a whole section that you can read about cards, but let me show you an example. Let's say near the beginning of the video over here, 10 seconds, I'm going to add a card. What's going to happen is something will pop up, but it'll pop up differently than the annotations. It sort of looks nicer and newer and more enticing to click on. You can either add a video, a channel, or a link. So let's say I've gone through the process of verification and my YouTube channel is officially a representation of my website, victor.com. So let's say I've verified. And at 10 seconds here, I want to add a link. Where I can link to a website. I can add my website right here. Here's examples, merchant site, crowdfunding site, my website, but I haven't verified it yet. The concept of this is at 10 seconds, I will get a pop-up that happens on the side over here that looks really nice, that has a thumbnail of my website and a message that I write to stand out because people are becoming numb to the annotations. The annotations can look very cluttered. You've probably seen a bunch of YouTube videos with very ugly text on them that you ignore. Mm-hmm. Cards are a way now to get our attention again, to get people's attention, because they'll have a nice thumbnail, they'll have nice text and a little call-out design. So cards are like annotations 2.0. And I would recommend you use cards instead of annotations, just because they're newer. Not everyone even knows about them or uses them. But if I show one of my examples over here, I probably have a card somewhere that's going to pop up. Somewhere. Maybe over here. Yeah, I forget which one specifically to show, but I have them also. Oh, I think I've got it over here.
Hey everyone, it's been a few years now, but let's take a look at the newest Opera Mini. Hey everyone, it's been a few years now.
It's kind of rolled out.
Let's take a look at the newest.
I'm suggesting go watch this other video. This is a continuation of a video I made a few years ago.
8.1 Windows Phone.
That other video.
So I've got the Opera Mini beta. Right here.
See, it's always going to be up there.
I like it because
it's
got
you. Look at that.
It
looks much nicer
than
the plain old annotation.
Screen for
this video that I did a few years ago has 3,000 views.
On a
and it's
basis.
When this software was old and buggy,
Here's
and then I did
Wikipedia.
A new review of it where now it's amazing.
And
so I've linked
I
the two. I'm getting still getting traffic from that old video.
Pretty fast.
But on that
Opera
video,
really
I have the same thing. I have a card on that video that pops up.
at a certain point that says,
okay, everyone,
hey, check out
welcome. I'm going
to
check out
look at the
Opera
new
Mini
so
for
that's
iOS.
Pop out in a different way than
so on the left, I've got the iPhone 4, which I got pretty recently, a couple of months.
Cards, and they're all going to be listed here.
Show you what's going on. So I've got
so when people see this one and see there's
Opera
a new
Mini,
view, they can click on that
the latest
one
version.
And, take them
and on both of these
the
devices,
one,
I'm running iOS 4.1. 4.2 isn't quite available yet. So let's start them up.
So cards.
What I like about Opera Mini is
from one channel
just
to another,
Opera in general. I like having an alternative web browser. So for example, here on the home page, the start page, I've got my favorite website. So let's check out Wikipedia. Okay, here's the first page on Wikipedia. Scroll around a little bit. I'll try to swipe at the same rate on both devices.
You could link them all together, yeah.
Now, hopefully you can see that the
I would link them, of course, if they make sense. If I've got a dog walking business and a bakery and a web design business, they don't really relate, so I don't know really why I would link to them.
Very responsive.
But if they relate,
on the other hand,
you can link channels.
The swiping motion on the
I don't have any other videos to show.
iPod.
But I have playlists.
Touch
I could say, okay, let's
on
create
the
a card
iPhone,
to
I
link
mean,
to this other
is
playlist.
It's kind of choppy. Let's look at a page.
And it doesn't
over
have to be
here.
Your own video or your own playlist. You can link
back.
To someone else completely different.
Let's look at something with a bit more
but you're probably
graphical
use
quality.
This to self-promote.
So if we go to screwattack.com.
So any, yeah.
Let's see how that works.
Mm-hmm. No, you have options under notes. I can do here.
And
I guess
do the zoom in.
Kind of limited. Well, a note is an annotation, but what about
so
label?
Hopefully you can see that
label.
It looks really choppy.
Yeah, the
scrolls
text
really,
really
choppy,
I guess,
is.
Can be black or white.
On the iPod Touch
the
second generation,
color,
I'm scrolling through the
colors.
Through the page
stand
very
out. So the one good thing about annotations is you've got some customization.
It's just
you can
not
place
acceptable.
It but again, there's
the iPod,
we've had so many years of bad annotations that are
4.
Ugly. That if you're using the brand new cards, that's a new way to get attention that your competitors are probably not
go back
taking
home.
Advantage.
Hopefully there will be a new version of Opera Mini.
Hello,
coming
everyone,
to iOS because I really, really like that web browser.
Road, and I'm going to review.
And I just wanted to bring this to your attention.
So this is the Motorola Moto E phone. It's a really good phone, very high tech. You need to be editing your video. If you're not editing the video, you're not going
to
see annotations.
Send and receive messages via voice. So it's very, very cool.
Hey guys, Homemade Geek Squad
so
here, and today we're going to be taking
Moto
a look
X is
at Opera
cool
6 on the iPad.
It, really
it was released today,
thing
and it is quite the web browser for the iPad for free.
Not
so let's get to the review.
Okay guys, so here are with Opera Mini 6 on my iPad, and right off the bat, there's one
of
the newest features for it. It is supported on the iPad, and it looks fantastic, I must say. And it is also supported on the Retina display for the iPhone 4, so the web quality and picture quality of the experience on the web using Opera Mini 6 has jumped right up alongside Mobile Safari. I really, really do enjoy using Opera, and I'll show you guys why. Right off the bat, I want to let you guys know in Opera Mini 6 that you're going to have a smoother panning and improved pinch to zoom experience. I've noticed it. You'll probably notice it if you're familiar with the old Opera Mini. And there's also some other cool features such as sending pages right to Twitter or Facebook or to your My Opera account. I really enjoy that because then I can post it to my friends on Facebook or post it out to you guys on Twitter. And then other news, it supports Arabic, Chinese, and other non-Latin languages. So let's get to the actual web browser here. Right off the bat, we have a home page, which is sort of like a, you know, your Safari favorites page or a Google page or the Google Chrome opening page. Your favorite websites, you can put them in here. Now, these are the defaults, and they simply work as you just click them. And then boom, and there you are. Now right up here you guys have the address bar, your tabs, your refresh, and your back.
So,
and then this is your little Opera page. I just got your menu, your Opera menu, where you can look at your bookmarks, your history, your start page, which will take
you
right back to that.
Subtitles,
and then you also have the share option and save pages, and then you can go into the settings and mess around with it. You can say what kind of quality you want out of the images, text wrapping, mobile view, all that kind of stuff. A lot of little things in there. But let's say we want to share a page. So let's go to CNN.com. Loads up pretty quickly.
You can do different languages. That's also useful.
I think it, by default, you have to go to the mobile page. You can turn it off so it takes to the desktop version. But say I wanted to share this, I could simply click that. Click share. And then set up your accounts and you can share away. Like I said, guys, I really think this is a great web browser. I love the tabs. I like how big they are. I think that's pretty cool. And then you also have your Google search over here. I forgot to mention that. But I think that Opera Mini 6 really comes up alongside with Mobile Safari. Now, I know neither of them support Flash, so I know it's a big turnoff to a lot of you guys. However, this is just a – I have enjoyed this experience with the Opera Mini on my iPad more than I have enjoyed Mobile Safari on my iPad. That's just my opinion. What do you guys think? Is this the type of web browser you're going to use? Try it out and tell me what you guys think. And if you haven't used it, tell me what you think after using it, and if you would, use this over Mobile Safari. But that is it, guys. One last thing is, if you want to add something, you just enter the address. It'll show your last pages. So now CNN's right there. I just wanted to show you guys that before I go away. But thank you, guys. Please subscribe to my channel up top. Comment down below. And as always, peace.
It's obviously not quite fully understanding what I'm saying, but the good news is...
Hello everyone and welcome to another On The Road review.
You know I'm on the road,
so I'm on the road and I'm going to review...
Learning something that would take many, many years to do, but you're able to do it here in a very reasonable and measurable amount of time.
And it's taught by the folks who are world-renowned in their fields.
Giving me a solid foundation in each layer gives me more information that I can apply on a day-to-day basis.
The tips, techniques is going to directly translate Monday when I'm back in the office.
So your return on your investment is immediate.
I expect it to be great, and it was.
I do that a lot. I let YouTube get started. It's going to make a lot of mistakes. But at least
what's up, guys? Quick app review for you on a much anticipated application. I'm going to be reviewing the Opera Mini browser for the iPhone and iPod Touch. Now, this is a browser that's on the computer also, which I've actually never used, but I've heard good things about it. I just actually haven't never got around to trying it out. But I have to say, the browser, the Opera Mini browser on the iPhone is amazing, and it's definitely going to replace my Safari browser. So let's go ahead and open it up. It is a free download. I'll have a link below this video if you'd like to download it. So here we go. We got the application open. Let's zoom in just a tad bit so you can see this a little bit better.
So between 7 seconds and 11 seconds.
So here on the home page, or the tabs page, you're going to call it. We've got 1, 2, 3. We got 9 tabs where you can basically it's just quick links where you can tap it and it'll go and load directly to a website, and you can set that whatever you want.
You then just need to
here I've got Twitter, Google AdSense, YouTube, my other YouTube channel, Apple, Google, and Mashable, and that's the only ones I've got. But you can use these quick links. All you got to do is tap on one. You can fill in your address that you want, or you can go through the addresses that you've been to before to add them. We've got the forward and back buttons. We've got tabs, and I actually loaded up these, and I loaded up, I think, 15 tabs, and I could keep making more and more. So I'm not sure the limit on tabs that you can make on this, but it's definitely a lot because it kept letting me do it. I was like, all right, I'm just going to say you can put a lot of tabs while I was playing around with it. So all you got to do to switch between tabs is click on it. Say we want to load up Twitter.
I've seen a place where you can edit from the screen, but they change this stuff all the time.
Then we want to go to a new tab. We want to load up YouTube. Then we want to go to a new tab. We can sit over the side and then say we wanted to go to Google. And that's basically how the tabs work, and you can switch between them.
So you don't have to download.
And that's how it works. Now let's look at the some of the settings of it. Hit the settings button. We've got bookmarks. Let's go ahead and tap that. You can, like when you're on a website, if you would like to add a site to your bookmarks, you just hit add Twitter. As you see, it's on there. You can add that to your bookmarks, like go to the site and then open up the bookmarks tab and hit add Twitter. You can manage it. Hit the trash can to delete it. Yes, confirm it. And yeah, I'm just going to go back through that. So that's your bookmarks. We've got history. You can browse through all of your history that you've been to. You can clear it out by hitting the clear button. I'm not going to do that because I want to keep it for this review. You can go to your start page, which takes you back to all your quick links. We've got saved pages, which basically I don't really understand the point of that. If you want to bookmark, sorry, hit my camera there. If you want to bookmark a page, you're probably going to want to save the page. It's basically the same thing, if you get what I mean, but works the same way as bookmarks. We've got settings. Let's take a look at those. You can set to load images on or off. That helps web pages load faster. You can set your image quality to low, medium, or high.
Subtitles?
I've got mine set to high. I'm just going to go back. You can set the font size. So if you need glasses or you're bad at reading on the iPhone, hurt your eyes or something, you can make the fonts bigger. We've got mobile view, which this is a great, great feature right here because I hate when YouTube will load up in the mobile site and I don't want it to. And it definitely comes in handy. You can just hit the button and it'll do it for you. So we can turn that on and off. We can turn on and off full screen, which I'll show you in just a second. We can turn off Opera Link. This is like a thing, as I said, I've never used Opera before. But this is a thing where you can link up to all of your accounts and address books and stuff like that with Opera. I'm not going to get into that because I have really no idea about that. We've got privacy. You can set it to remember passwords. That's another good thing about this. This browser is it will actually remember your passwords, unlike the Safari browser. You can accept cookies, you can clear history, clear passwords, clear cookies. So let's just go back. And then we've got advanced, which will let you change the protocol and the start page links on or off.
But this is a whole new world.
So that's basically the settings of it. We'll go back, and now we do have mobile view turned on and full screen. I'm going to turn mobile view off for now. You guys know what mobile view is. It's basically just loading up sites in their mobile site to fit the iPhone. But I'm going to leave full screen on. Let's go back to the settings again. It's got a find in page option. So let's go ahead and click on one of the tabs that we've got open. We'll go to YouTube. Okay. We'll go to settings and then find in page.
Studies are showing people are consuming.
And basically what it's going to do is just bring up the keyboard and we can search a page for something. Let's search. I'm just going to search comments.
The examples that I gave in my handout,
because I know that's on the page.
Possible ideas.
And then you hit next, and then you see it drags you down to your comments. And then if you hit next, it's going to bring you to the next place where it says comments. So that's basically how it works. It's just fine in page.
Not the language of the audio.
And then we've got help. And that's just the links to learn more about Opera. So it does. It saves passwords. The zooming in, like the zooming in on it, you've got to like double tap. Now it looks kind of weird when it does it. You can pinch in, and then when you pinch out again, it's going to zoom out. I don't really like that about it. I would like to be able to zoom in on the thing and like zoom in a little bit more if I'd like to, but it zooms you right back out. You can double tap. It kind of does a quick little zoom in, as you see, and a quick little zoom out. It works pretty good, actually, though. I guess it's just something I get used to. But oh my god, I love this browser right here. It's so much better than Safari. It's faster. It's so many more, like, it's so featured. It's everything that the iPhone browser needs to have. And it's just amazing. And that's the full screen view, if you see. Okay, there was a full screen view. We just hit this button to bring back up the menu. And that's basically how the application works. We got a little refresh button right here. It's basically like any other browser where we got the address bar up here at the top and the Google search bar. And it's an awesome browser. Hopefully I covered everything. Check it out. It is free in the App Store. This is definitely going to replace my Safari browser. I'm going to go ahead and do that now. Goodbye, Safari browser.
All on the same one.
And hello, Opera.
On the same channel.
Thanks for watching, guys. Hopefully you enjoyed this. If you did, please be sure to rate this video, or like this video, sorry. And leave me some comments below. Tell me what you think about the new Opera browser. As I said, look below the video and you will get a download link for it. Please, if you enjoyed this video and you'd like to see more of my videos, click the little subscribe button above this video, and I would appreciate that. So thanks for watching, guys. See you guys in the next video. Peace out.
Yeah. You can make multiple playlists, and you can put a video into as many playlists as you want.
Also, do it by language.
Yeah, do it by language. And then maybe link them all together with cards. Because under cards, then you could say, link it to the Spanish playlist.
Hello, YouTube.
Playlist.
What's up?
And that way you drive traffic between different playlists and different languages.
I'm going to show you the brand new Opera Mini web browser. That's available in the Apple iStore. You've got the first ever web browser.
I don't think so. I think that's one of the limitations that audio is kind of limited. The only overdubbing that it lets you is that you can use one of the pre-approved YouTube sounds and put it on top of your video. Besides that, you cannot add your own extra audio tracks.
It's not going to cost you anything to download or install.
To my knowledge, at this point, the closest is subtitles. Maybe in a future update, they will let you swap out soundtracks. It's probably coming. Who knows?
I already have it installed. Let's get into it right now. This is Opera Mini. That's the new
Now you've got a brand new YouTube channel to explore, to create videos, to upload, to check these different screens. The point of it, just like Twitter, let's say, on Twitter, Facebook, Pinterest, you want to tweet often. You want to pin often, you want to post on Facebook often, you want to do videos often. Videos obviously are much more work than a tweet. So a good goal is to think about publishing one video per month. So within 30 days, hopefully you're able to create one video. And you're not required to do 10 minutes, 15 minutes. We did a minute and a half. You can do it 1 minute, 30 seconds. You can make them just about any length. I think as a beginner, that's a good goal. Once a month, one video. The better you get at it, perhaps, maybe. I did two this month. Next month, I'll do one. I'm burnt out. Then next month, I got three great ideas. I'll upload three. So the more content you put, the better. Because once you watch a particular video, it's going to do suggestions. At the end of this video, watch this. At the end of this video, it's going to give you these suggestions. Why not also see this one, and this one, and this one? Well, because I only have one video, it's going to suggest a bunch of other people's reviews. The more videos that I add, it will fill up my suggestions with my own videos. And now, nowadays, YouTube has this auto option, which I hate, but as a content creator, I like this. As a viewer, I don't like this, but as a content creator, I like this. Well, it didn't do it this time, but did you see that autoplay? It was about to automatically go to another video. I don't like that myself. I want to watch the videos that I want to watch. But as a content creator, I like that. I want my video to possibly show up for someone else's video. I could cancel, so I ignored it. That was autoplay. Again, the more of your content that exists, the more probability that it will be shown to people. And it not necessarily means that you need to have 26,000 reviews, I mean views, to be seen. You don't need to have these thousands of views to be seen. The point is, everyone starts somewhere. The people that have the 10,000 reviews are next to this 90,000 review person is right next to 1,000 views. And the more views you get, the more you could be, featured more, shared more, but you need to put more content out there.
Search.
What are you searching for? It might be that the video is so new, it hasn't fully traveled all of through YouTube, and maybe those search terms, they're not quite active yet. So what I do for clients is I don't just go to YouTube and upload their video and sit back and watch the views come back. I also upload the video and then I share it on their Facebook and I share it on their Twitter and Google Plus everywhere. I also get traffic from those other networks. So it's not just that I'm only going to rely on traffic on YouTube. If I've got 40 followers on Twitter and I don't have them following me on YouTube, well, I'm letting them know on Twitter. I'm also on YouTube. Here it is. I'm going to share it on Twitter. So you should always be cross-promoting, cross-pollinating. You should always be putting your YouTube videos also on Facebook. You should also be mentioning your tweets on Pinterest. You should always be linking them together.
So you go back to the dashboard and to do that? Or?
That's right. That's right. So as we end the class, then those are many things to think about. In these 8 weeks that we've been here, we've talked about a bunch of social networks. This class is an overview to get you to think about, what did I like? What did I not like? What am I good at? What am I not good at? The easy answer is get on all the social networks. That's obviously harder, easier said than done, especially video. So with this class, I hope that you continue to explore these social networks, keep getting better at them, and keep enjoying using them. So we're going to end at this point. We'll have a little bit of lab time. Thanks for taking the class.
Well, thank you.